We are celebrating Black History Month and we have Lauren Simmons, who was the second African American and the youngest ever female trader in NYSE history. Lauren, thank you so much for being part of this.
Thank you guys for having me for Black History Month. So exciting.
Yes, we are having you for Black History Month. So starting the question from Black History Month, what does Black History Month mean to you?
It means a legacy. It means all the incredible men and women that have come before me, my family, that have paved the way for me to be able to have a legacy, be able to make history at the New York Stock Exchange, to be able to have these opportunities, and where I'm at today. Black history, you know, is one of the foundations to American history. And I think so often throughout American history, we don't highlight all the success that African Americans have had for America in this country. And it's just really phenomenal that we get to set aside an entire month and be able to dive into the culture and to learn more about our ancestors, or to learn about the journey that we often didn't get to see as much, especially when I was growing up in school. And so I'm just so grateful to be in a time where we can openly have these conversations, and it makes everyone better generationally, within other ethnicities and other races and other cultures. I think it's something empowering to be part of a melting pot and to be able to share our stories with one another and to push each other to greatness.
Mm-hmm. I know you have shared this story a million times, but still we need to talk about it, your professional career. So you became the youngest ever and second African American female trader in NYSE history. Can you briefly walk us through your story? Briefly.
Briefly. So in 2017, yes, I became the youngest female trader, or the youngest trader at the New York Stock Exchange, as well as the second and the exchange is 226 years at the time. And I was also the only female trader working in a room with 250 men. And, you know, my story short and sweet. I came from Georgia, did not have a finance background, did not go to Ivy League, but I made my way to New York determined to find a job in finance. That did not, in my mind, ever cross being the New York Stock Exchange, but through the power of networking, I met an incredible individual who connected me with the men at the New York Stock Exchange, and was hired on the spot by Richard Rosenblatt of Rosenblatt Securities. And I was there for about 2 years, and it was an incredible journey to be there for my first 2 years out of college and to learn so much so quickly. So I'm super grateful.
Right. And since you have left NYSE, you have been working as a speaker on personal finance, especially for women and minorities. In your interactions with them, like, what sort of misconception have you found in regards to, you know, personal finance, and what do you want to say on that?
Yeah, so I mean, outside of me being a speaker, I think everything that I do is an extension of me. So, you know, being a producer on a biopic of my life story, being now a TV host, being an executive producer on another TV series that I can't wait for everybody to hear more about. But everything that I do is all about empowering the next generation when it comes to finance. And that can be involved in the stock market, or that could just be everyday personal finance. And I think finance has got this facade that, you know, it's not inclusive, and it can be, and it's a lot easier than people think it is. But oftentimes, I think the disconnect with many male-dominated industries and what that can look like is the exposure and seeing somebody that has been there and done it before. And I'm so happy that I get to be the face for this next generation and to let them not be scared, or to let them understand that finance is easy. once you learn the basics, and to be able to have that fluid conversation, and for them to see that it's not just an all white boys club that, you know, many multifaceted people are a part of that industry is so rewarding. And it's even more rewarding being an African American woman and seeing that I can impact so many African American women, but also just African Americans in general, their life. And I'm excited to be hopefully the stepping stone to start creating generational wealth here in America for African Americans.
Since you have mentioned all white men's club, if you look at the CEOs of Fortune 500 companies, less than 8% are female and even less constitute a minority group. So why do you think diversity matters, and how can companies benefit from striving for greater diversity?
I think we all know that diversity, it pushes companies, it pushes individuals to think and to be better. Being in a melting pot, you don't get a one-sided collective thought. You get everybody's experiences, cultures, backgrounds coming together. And I think that only empowers us for the better. And statistics have shown that companies that are more diverse do significantly better. So we know that the statistics are on our side. We know that this is a direction that we need to be going. Unfortunately, I think people get stuck in their ways and they figure they don't need to. And so they've chosen not to. And that is why in 2021, there still is a lack of diversity and in many male-dominated spaces such as finance and tech and so on and so forth. So I think we have a long way to go, but I do think people understand and they recognize the importance of diversity. It's now taking the actual action steps to implement them and to say, you know what, we're going to actually do it and be open to open thoughts. And I think it all starts with leadership. If the people at the top don't want to see those changes being done, then they're not going to be done.
Switching gears to entrepreneurship, you started your career by working for somebody else. Now you are working for yourself, meaning you are your own boss. So when is the right time to be your own boss? And what is your advice for other entrepreneurs?
You know, I think for me, had my life not gone in the direction that it went and I was given certain opportunities, I do think I probably would have ended up working for another big company. But at the same time, I do push for entrepreneurship. I think it's absolutely phenomenal if you can run your own company. But I also understand that everybody is not fit to be an entrepreneur. They are very self-sufficient and fine working for other individuals, which I think is just as important because you can't run a company all by yourself. You do have to have a team as put together as I may look. Like, I have incredible people that work with me and for me, and I'm so grateful for it. But to get back to the question of when is the right time, I think falling back on yourself, you knowing yourself better than anyone else. And if the time feels right, if you feel like you have learned all the tools and resources to have a successful company, and or you feel like you have made such a niche where you can't learn from another individual on the type of products and services that you're trying to do, and you say, you know what, I'm going to do it, I think that is absolutely the right time. You know, entrepreneurship isn't easy and you will get told a lot of no's. But I think once you get into that groove of everything just falling into alignment, it can be, you know, very, very rewarding.
Right. And Lauren, do you think people are more into entrepreneurship these days because the word entrepreneur sounds so sexy?
I think, studies show, statistics show that the next generation, Gen Z, they will be the largest generation with the most entrepreneurs. And I think there are so many reasons for that. Entrepreneur, it's sexy to say, but also I feel like people definitely understand where they can make their market, and they're doing at such a rapid speed that they don't need gatekeepers to make their dreams a reality. And so they're just doing it. And I find that so exciting and refreshing that so many people feel determined that they can do these things. And so I don't think people should stray away from it whatsoever. I think that there is power in you know, companies coming up and seeing that they can make their mark. And we see that. And I'm grateful for the time to be in where people can be given those opportunities and can be successful doing it.
Right. And investing in stock market, especially during these times, have been easy because of the new app like Robinhood, Stash, and other bunch of apps. So as a former trader on NYSE, what advice do you want to give to young investors who are new to investing, especially in the stock market?
Don't. you know, the market is definitely still very volatile at the moment. We have the pandemic going on. We have the economy, the staggering unemployment rates and everything that's being affected by this pandemic. So I don't think that, you know, right now is probably the best time to invest in the market. But with, you know, new progress coming along and the vaccine rolling out, I do think, you know, later this year, it'll definitely be a better experience. But what I say to most people that are trying to invest, make sure that you're absolutely ready. Don't invest for short-term gains. Don't invest because of speculation of certain things that are going on that's trendy in the news. You really want to look at long-term avenues. And so, you know, I know people would love to believe that I follow the stock market all day long and I'm looking at graphs and charts. I don't. I invested sometime early last March when the market crashed, and I periodically will check in, and that's just my game plan at the moment. I don't get too excited over different things that are going on in the market because there's just so much uncertainty that's going on at the moment. But also for my young investors, the reality is that many of you are not in a position to be investing, and that is perfectly okay. I know that there has been so much information out there that says invest now and invest as early as you can. And I agree to a certain extent, but there should definitely be an asterisk at the end of that statement, because the reality is that one in four Americans before the pandemic didn't even have enough money for a $300 emergency fund. And student loans are at all-time high, credit card debt is at all-time high. And if you have all those things, you don't have an emergency fund, you don't have, you have student loans, you have credit card debt, you haven't put money towards retirement, your extra expendable cash should not be going to the stock market. The returns on it are not grand enough for the high interest rates that you have on all those other things that I've listed previously. So I think if you don't have any of those things, yes, the stock market could be a good place, but I would be very cautious about, again, what you're putting your money into. Definitely do your research. There's so many great tools and resources that are out there. People always ask, you know, we all have this always in our hand. And I just tell people, like, please, 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 do your research, do your due diligence. And if anything sounds too good to be true, it 99% probably is, because if it was that easy, we would all be doing it.
Okay, switching back to you again, a biographical movie is being made on you. How excited are you, and what new can we expect from that movie?
I think people will get to understand my journey to the New York Stock Exchange and what it was like. I mean, I had, for the most part, an incredible experience, but I do think, especially looking back, there was definitely a lot of red tape and a lot of barriers that I had to go through or didn't even realize while I was in it that I was going through it. But I want people to have the authentic truth as to what my journey was like. And, you know, it was a good experience, but that doesn't mean that it was fully easy, and that's perfectly okay. I'm so excited for Kiersey Clemons to be playing me. She's just such a phenomenal individual. Our relationship has grown so much over the past 2 years, and I love seeing her play me out. I also am very much in love with the script and the director, and there will be more announcements hopefully very soon. But we've been working on this project for 2 years now, and I'm just so excited to be a producer on a biopic on my life story, which is just surreal because I'm now 26 and I think, this is absolutely insane. But again, this is all an extension of me, and hopefully we'll be able to empower the next generation of incredible, fearless history makers in the making.
Yeah, fun question. Why didn't you play yourself in the movie?
Actress, if I was, oh my goodness. But no, I mean, that would be crazy.
Anyway, so besides movie, now another big news. You are hosting an interactive streaming series going public. For those who don't know what that is, so what is your goal for the show and why should we tune in?
Yeah, so going public is absolutely groundbreaking. I cannot say it enough. Thank you, Todd and Darren, for coming to me, attaching me to this project as the host. Going public, we get to follow the journey of five companies as they get listed at the NASDAQ in real time. And essentially, it's all about democratizing IPOs. I mean, just think of your Airbnbs and all the companies that you've grown to love over the years, and you either have been users of their services and platforms, but so often we don't get the opportunity to participate in the IPO, only institutional investors or people of a certain net worth. And going public is groundbreaking because anybody who's over the age of 18 will be able to buy into the companies that they already know and love. There is no convincing of the products and services that these companies do. And I think it is very extraordinary and telling to be able to be part of hopefully investing in, you know, the next Tesla or Amazon. And I'm just so excited to be part of it. I'm so excited to be able to break down the roadshow and how people raise capital and what that whole process is like, and people to do their due diligence and to make the best decision as far as if they should invest in the company. And one other thing that I'm really excited about with going public is the diversity and inclusion component. Again, so many IPOs that are listed are not a representation of, you know, what Americans look like. I think there have only been 20 or 22, if I'm not mistaken, IPOs that have been women founded that have listed at the New York Stock Exchange. I mean, that's absolutely insane in 2021. And so, yes, the companies that we're following are diverse. They're young, they're old, they come from all different backgrounds. And there's so much to be learned from these incredible entrepreneurs, these incredible companies. And I'm so excited to be on this journey.
We are almost at the end of the conversation. So you have made a huge career strides at a young age. Any tips for college graduates who are looking to get started?
Yes, be fearless. Again, I often say, like, you know yourself better than anyone else. And it's establishing that trust and that relationship with yourself first. You will get so much advice, as I did when I moved to New York and had people saying I was reaching too high, or I didn't have any clear direction of what it is that I wanted to do. And through, I always knew who Lauren Simmons was. And sometimes advice from other people, you'll get so much advice, but I take it with a grain of salt, and whatever feels good to you and what feels like can empower you, you take that advice and you move forward. And so the next generation, it's really about establishing that relationship with yourself, because you definitely know the right answers and the tools and the resources. And yes, you'll definitely need help along the way, but I don't think all advice is good advice. And I think the more that you start trusting in your decisions and how you're maneuvering through your journey at a college, if you end up going to college, or just your journey throughout your career, the better you will be. And that is all about the relationship that you have with yourself. So I say, as early as possible, start, you know, believing in yourself and developing out that relationship and realizing that you have all the tools and the resources to make the very best decisions for yourselves. And I mean, just highlighting incredible entrepreneurs such as Jamie Schmidt, who will be part of going public, but just thinking of like the Elon Musk and the Jeff Bezos. I mean, they had so many people tell them no, but they followed their gut, their intuition, their heart, their soul. And even when moments got rough, they definitely leaned on themselves. And I think it really is establishing that trust with yourself. I think I've said yourself so many times. But I mean, it's so true.
Okay, last question before I let you go. So when you saw Kamala Harris taking the oath as the first woman, first Black American, first Asian American vice president, what significance do you think that moment will make in history down the lane?
This just opens up so many opportunities. I mean, I'm so grateful to be in a time that we're in. I think Kamala is absolutely amazing. And I personally had been following her journey while I was at the New York Stock Exchange. I was in Washington being honored at another event, and it was the first time that I heard of Kamala, and I just thought how groundbreaking this woman was and what her journey would be. And for her to get so far and to become, you know, a vice president, I think is absolutely incredible. I mean, we are definitely making strides in history. Definitely making strides in America. I know oftentimes there's a push-pull effect, but I'm so grateful because we can now say that a woman has done it, she's doing it, and this is only going to open the door for more opportunities for women of color here in America. And I'm just, again, I can't say it enough. I'm so grateful to be in such a high position. And to be regarded in so much respect. I mean, oftentimes we think about incredible women and, you know, they, you know, haven't reached the heights that I guess, you know, Kamala has. It's absolutely incredible. And not to discount any other woman, I love other women that have come before Kamala and they haven't even been women of color. Hillary Clinton, like, thank you, thank you, thank you. Ruth Bader, like there have just been so many, but I think to be able to make this point and to become vice president, it's just an incredible time to be alive.
Thank you so much, Lauren, for your time.